Any loving father will give their children instructions to keep them safe from all forms of evil, harm, and danger. How many fathers in the house agree with that? Raise your hand.
Hallelujah.
How many loving fathers do we have here? I see a bunch of loving fathers. So we give our children instructions to keep them safe from evil, from harm, from all that would try to cause them to go astray. And that's what the word Torah means. It means the instructions of a loving father. So I'm going to open up with a blessing before we enter in. Rachut et Yehovah, Amavarak. Baruch Yehovah, Amavarak, Le'olam Vahed. Baruch Atah Yehovah, Eloheinu Melech Ha'olam. Asher Bakar Banu Miko Ha'amim. Venatan Anu Et Torata. Baruch Atah Yehovah, Noten Ha'Torah. Blessed are you, Yahweh, the Blessed One. Blessed is Yahweh, the Blessed One for all eternity. Blessed are you, Yahweh, our Elohim, King of the universe, who selected us from other people and gave us His Torah, His instructions. Blessed are you, Yahweh, giver of the Torah. And everybody say,
Amen.
Say like you mean it.
Amen.
Don't be shy. You know, out there in the world, you guys were shouting on the weekends, sometimes over things that really meant nothing. You just wanted to shout. So we need to be confident in the things of God. Okay, our Torah portion is going to begin in the book of Numbers, Bamidbar, chapter 8, verse 1. It's actually a long study. It really is. It's a total of 5 chapters. We're not going to cover every single thing, but we're going to cover a lot of information today. Historical things, things that can apply to our life, things of the future, and things that are impending right now as we're here in this nice so-called free country, the land of the free. It's really the land of the distractions, to distract us from what is really going on. And you can look at those who are professionals, scientists, and those who have classified badges that are 28 levels above top secret. And they're beginning to come out and expose so much that is happening right now. And we can see these things all around us. This is a very, very pinnacle year. This is not only a Shemitah year that we are in, but we're about to approach the year of Jubilee, a Jubilee season. So this is a very fascinating time. All right, so we have the name of our Torah portions. Anybody know it? Say it again. Yeah, it's a long one. It's a tongue twister. Beha'alotcha. Can you guys say that? Beha'alotcha. So we're going to give like a little Hebrew lesson of the name of the Torah portion and then get into it in just a moment. But Proverbs 20, verse 27 says, the spirit of man is the lamp of Yahweh, searching all the innermost parts of the person. I have a subtitle for this week's Torah portion, which is the power of kindling a flame. The power of kindling the flame. And I have a question for you guys. Is your flame set on fire, or is it just flickering? Or do you stand here today in need of an ignition inside of the flame of your heart and your soul and your spirit? And I'm going to have to say, excuse the noise here. There's a business next door. They tend to get pretty loud sometimes. It seems like they're done with their forklift, but hopefully they're done for the day, so there's no interruptions. If they happen to pull that forklift out, we're going to probably have to shut that back door, and it gets a little warm, but I think we'll be fine. But let's get into this here. Let's say this together. Gal Ainai Be'abita Niflaot Mitorateka. Unveil my eyes, and I may behold wondrous signs from your Torah. Odecha al ki noraot nivleti niflaim masecha v'nafshim yodaat me'ot. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works, and my soul knows it very well. All right, here's our Torah portion, beginning in Bamidbar chapter 8, all the way to chapter 12, verse 16. Zechariah is the half Torah portion, chapter 2, verse 10, all the way to 4:14. But as you guys can see, there is a spirit of prophecy that has descended and is coming upon the people, or the house of Ephraim. You guys know that Ephraim is a scattered house of Israel. Because of rebellion, we have been scattered into the nations, and we don't even know what we are unless we come through the door, which is Yeshua, as some might know as Jesus, but Yeshua is the door into the house of God, and we find our identity in the house. We, especially young people, you'll never find your identity in the world. The world will try to stamp you and label you as something that you really are not. But in the house of God, in the house of Elohim, you find your true identity, who you are to become, and who you have always intended to be. Alright, so we see this. We need the Ruach HaKodesh. We need the Holy Spirit flowing out of us completely. We need the Spirit of Elohim flowing out of us in full power. This portion deals with the lighting of the menorah by Aaron and the Kohanim, or the Kohen Hagadol, the work of the Levites in the Mishkan and the temple to come, and the second Passover. It also discusses the divine signs accompanying the children of Israel and their journeys. Following this is the account of the complainers. I think we've all come across complainers in our life. There's always going to be complainers in the house of Elohim and just in the world in general. We have the dissatisfaction of the manna that was given to the children of Israel. And then Moshe's despair. He's actually come to a low place in his life, and he begins to ask, why has Elohim done such an evil? But the Father's going to help Moses out in his struggle. Alright, so we see this. And then we see there's an anointing upon 70 elders amongst the community of Israel. And that is supposed to be the first Sanhedrin council that was anointed with a portion for just a moment, a season and time, which had never happened again until the book of Acts chapter 2. And this portion ends with Miriam. She winds up getting leprosy because she was what? Speaking evil. Lashon hara, that evil tongue, my gosh. The evil tongue, the gossip, the tale bearing, all these things, it is a poison. And Miriam, who was a prophetess according to the book of Exodus chapter 15, verse 20, I think it is, she knew better. And judgment came upon her, all right? But let's open up with the name of the Torah portion, Beha'alotcha. Can you guys say that again? Beha'alotcha. That's how you say that. Well, let's look at the letters of this Torah portion. It's very, very telling. The letters of this Torah portion reveal very, very much. So let's look at this. To your left, going down, we have the letter Bet, which represents the house. It represents in. It looks like an aerial view of a house. You're looking at the house from the aerial view. The next letter is the Hebrew letter Hey. Now this is more of the pictographic form, an older form of how the Hebrew was written. That means behold, like behold. This is the letter ayin. It's an eye. It means to look or to weep. It also represents knowledge. We have the lamed, which is the shepherd's staff. It means to direct. It means to guide. It means to teach. And sometimes teaching or guiding becomes a goad because the flesh does not want to listen. So it's good for us. We have the letter vav, which represents a man. It represents to secure or to join things together. We have the letter tav, which represents the two cross sticks or the covenant. And then you have the letter kaf, which speaks of the palm of the hand. And what's interesting is when we put these together, it is actually a powerful phrase that deals with the essence of this Torah portion, which is, I want all of us to read it together. Behold, the whole house of Israel will look and weep for the shepherd whose crucifixion joins them together by the palms of his hands. So this is the name of the Torah portion, and this is exactly the revelation that is given to us in this week's Torah portion. All right? Just moving on. Here's a brief outline of all that is in this Torah portion. You can see there's a ton of information inside of this Torah portion. So much history. This is actually history that had transpired and had taken place. The name of this week's Torah portion, Beha'alotcha, actually comes from the Hebrew word Allah. Now, like the Muslim God Allah, it's something totally different. Allah means to go up, it means to ascend, it means to lift up, or to offer up. Another related word is Eleh, which is the Hebrew word for fig leaves. Remember when Adam and Eve sinned, They covered themselves with fig leaves, the scripture says, which is the same Hebrew word for excuses. So we see they covered themselves with excuses. Also, olah means a whole burnt offering, that which goes up from the altar of sacrifice. So the root of our Torah portion word tells us about the portion literally and prophetically. We see all of this, there's a transition that is taking place. We need to come from the place of fig leaves and excuses, and we need to arrive at the place of going up, the very heart of the name of this Torah portion, okay? We're going to enter into it right here, right now. Numbers chapter 8, verse 1. It says that Yahweh spoke, you can turn in Numbers chapter 8, verse 1 if you have your scriptures with you. And Yahweh spoke to Moshe saying, speak to Aaron and say to him, when you set up the lamps, that's the name of this Torah portion, Beha'alotcha. This actually means when you cause a flame of the lamp to ascend or to go up. Meaning that the priest would hold the fire to the lamp until it caught fire on its own and was able to hold the flame by itself without any other assistance from the priest. The same applies to the soul of a person. We must steadily hold the fire in our life to the soul of the other person we are raising up, fathers, mothers, children. That is called kindling the flame. The scripture also says, do not kindle a fire on Shabbat, and that has a negative connection. But there is that aspect of kindling the flame within the person, that flame of holiness, until that soul is no longer dependent upon us as parents, as grandparents, and so on and so forth. If we have a 30, 40, 50-year-old son still or daughter still living at home, something is not right. That means something didn't catch on the wick of their life, and there still needs to be that kindling in the heart and soul of that person. Like our children, we pour into them until there is no longer that kind of assistance needed in their life. That's called one of the greatest acts of loving kindness. Another interesting thing is the movement in prayer, also known as davening. You'll see the Jewish people moving back and forth like a flame, something we mentioned last night. It is the swaying back and forth like the flame itself. And I find myself personally doing this in my personal time of prayer. Interesting, the Hebrew word for flame is shalhevet, which equals 737. No, I don't have it up there. 737. Remember, every Hebrew word has a number connected to it. Every Hebrew letter has a number connected to it. And it's just profound how all of these things come together. But 737 actually gives us a part of the Shema that we declare. Bekol levavecha uvekol nefshecha uvekol me'odecha, which equals this. The flame that is there is saying this: to love with all your heart and all your soul and all your might. So it is the flame of love that has taken residence in three levels of our life: our spirit, our heart, and our body. And this has the same value of the word for the flame. You see, so we need to kindle that love in our soul. We need to kindle that love for Elohim in our heart. We need to kindle that love for Elohim in our mind. And we need to kindle that love for Him in the way we live, especially when we relate to people. We need to walk in loving kindness with one another. And I find it fascinating. It just blew my mind as I was doing the research on this. I was like, wow, what a beautiful insight. To set souls on fire is an act of deep love. Let the seven lamps give light in front of the lampstands, the scripture goes on to say. So when we contemplate upon the flame, we see there are three levels to this fire. You might have to shut that back door now. There they go with the forklift. I thought they retired that dinosaur. I thought there was an asteroid that hit this earth and there was no more dinosaurs, but we got one just constantly moving around. All right. Father, we pray that it does not get too hot in here. And keep this in prayer. We need to look for another building. Yes. All right, we need to look for another building. I know this is a new one, but it's time to look for another one because summer's coming up and it's going to get brutal up here. For you guys to be sitting here and I'm at home just trying to stay cool. You can't have that, right? Come on, you guys, snap out of it. So let's look at this here. So when we contemplate upon the flame, we see there are three levels to this fire. And when looking at the flame, we have the blue color on the inside that's attached to the very wick of the flame. If you get a candle, you see there's the blue flame, and then you see there's yellow, and then there's kind of like a white, and then an aura around it. If you were able to touch the blue fire, it would not burn your skin. Is that fascinating or what? It won't really do any too much damage to you. It's the white fire of it that can. This is called chashma. And I'm setting the foundation because this beginning part of this Torah portion with the kindling of the menorah has a lot to do as we begin to close the very Torah portion. But that's called, that first initial burning on the wick is called chashma. Can you guys say that? Chashma means to electrify. And notice that blue flame is connected to the wick. So the first thing is for the flesh of the person to be electrified. Something has to transpire within the flesh of the person before they can move on, which has to deal with the heart. Read another way, it's lev mashak, which means to anoint. The anointing that takes place is always in the realm of the physical. We don't need the anointing in the future kingdom. There's no need to be anointed. There's no need for the gifts of the Spirit. There's no need for any of that. So that tells me that's for now. That's for right now. This is the place of the anointing. The anointing is always connected to the natural realm. This part is always connected to the wick, the blue flame. Then there's the white part of the flame that surrounds the blue flame. This is called Esh, which means fire. Can you say Esh?
Esh.
This corresponds to the loving Elohim with all your soul. Loving Him with all of your soul. This love doesn't touch the physical body, meaning it is beyond an emotional love. You see, loving God the way He says, proof that you love Him is not how much we can cry. Even though we're emotional people and there's always a connection that causes the tears to flow from us all. But many tears is not proof that you love Him. Proof that we love the Creator Himself is doing what He says.
Yes.
Proof that we love Him is when He says, do this, we do it. The Messiah said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Proof that you love Him is in what we do. Then we have this other part of the flame, it's called the Nogah, the brightness or the shining, and this is corresponds to the loving Elohim with all of your might. The value of these three, bringing all of these together, once again, also equals 737. Where you love Him with all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. And that's all connected to the beginning part of this Torah portion that has to do with the flame or the lamp, the nair of that fire. This is what we all need. Let me see, I think I got something kind of backwards here. And I'm going to leave this out. So let's look at this. What is one of the greatest acts of kindness when it comes to those that will go before us? And it's what? Pouring into them until they no longer need us anymore. Imparting information, not for the sake of knowing, but for the sake of living. Pouring into our children all that we can so they no longer need us anymore. Doesn't mean that they won't come visit, but it means that they're no longer dependent upon us. Imagine a 20-year-old boy still breastfeeding on his mom. Now that would be really wrong. But imagine that. That means something transpired in the life to where that boy was not disconnected, did not find his independent self in Elohim to live on his own. So we see this moving on. In Numbers chapter 8, verse 3, it says, and Aaron did so. He set up the lamps to face toward the front of the lampstand, as Yahweh commanded Moshe. Verse 4. And this is the work of the lampstand, or the menorah. It's beaten work from its base to its blossoms. It is beaten work according to the pattern which Yahweh had shown Moses. So he made the lampstand. And this was the work of the menorah, hammered work of gold to its base and to its flowers. It was hammered work according to the pattern. And someone say vision. According to the pattern, miksha he. Say that. Say miksha he. That's the word in Hebrew, mikshahi, which means according to the hammered hymn. Makes no sense sounding like that, but that's what it says. We can each see how this one piece of pure gold or hammered work can relate to each one of us as well as the Messiah. First, we have the pure gold, which is a process of its own. Remember, to get pure gold, you got to put in some hot fire,
yes.
Right? And I first learned this, I think, back in like 2001. A friend of mine owns a jewelry shop, and he asked me a question. He said, how do you get pure gold? I said, I have no idea. And he says, what you do, he says, you heat it up. And as it stays under the fire, all of a sudden the other metals and impurities come to the surface. You scrape it off. And then you keep it in the fire because there's still some hidden impurities inside of the gold. And it comes up, you scrape it off. He says, how do you know when it's ready to be used? I said, I really have no idea. He says, it's simple. When the goldsmith can see his reflection in the gold. So first is pure gold. The Father has to heat us up, and He wants to see the reflection of Himself in our life of fire. And then He says, now I can mold you for a specific vessel, for a specific time, in a specific place, so that you can do a specific task. But until we become the pure gold, He can't do that. So that process is not always nice, and that process does not feel good. So this gold is heated up. Heated up very hot. When all the carnality is removed from our life, then we begin to press into holiness. When carnality is brought to the surface and removed, then we begin to be set apart. But until the carnality is removed, then we remain the same as we were before. So let's keep moving on with this. What is fascinating is this menorah represents light. It was the only fixture, vessel, in the holy place that illuminated everything else. So it represents light. Yeshua is the light of the world. He says, I am the light of the world. So the beaten or hammered work has a hidden identity. Now start following along, because we're going to look into a whole lot in this Torah portion that is very powerful and very life-changing, and it is cutting edge today. So you guys are probably going to hear some more things you have not heard before. Maybe a few things you have, but most of this you have not heard. So let's move on to this. So the beaten or hammered work has a hidden identity of the Master Yeshua. The word for mikshah comes from kasha, which means to be dense, listen, to be hardened, and to be harsh. So you see, the gold was used as a process, but then there was another time season that caused the gold to harden and become dense and to become thick and become heavy and weighty. The outer shell that becomes hardened and harsh. Yeshua took upon Himself the harshness of fallen man, and it is the judgment of Elohim that comes upon Him like a beaten work. In the book of Isaiah, it pleased the Father to inflict judgment upon the Master. It says it pleased Him to be inflicted with pain. It pleased the Father to bruise Him. Why? For the sake of beating? No. For the sake of what it would purchase, you and I. And this whole world back, and the land of Israel, believe it or not. There's so much more to this. Yeshua took upon Himself the sin of man, which is the leprous condition of mankind and the leprous condition of the world. The value of this word happens to be 405. Every letter has a number. Remember that. This is how you extract the beauty of the Torah. You start going in and pulling these treasures out. But the value of this equals 405, which gives us Ha-Metzorah, which is the leper. Yeshua is called the leper scholar. Remember that? It is also interesting that at the end of this Torah portion, Miriam, she is inflicted with leprosy. Right in the get-go, embedded inside of this very work of beaten work, we have the leper himself that will take upon the penalty of the sin of mankind. Through His loving work of redemption, we are sanctified. 405 also equals the word Ekadesh, which means I will set you apart. I will sanctify you. I will separate you from the ways of the world. I will set your mind apart. I will bring you to a place where you can shine like a menorah. This is what he's teaching us. Sanctification is seen in the beaten work of the menorah. The vision or the pattern that is seen, remember Moses sees the vision or the pattern, is the Hebrew word ka-mar-es. Say that. Ka-mar-es. Say it. Alright, good, very good. Ka-mar-es can be read as mar-ah, which means a mirror. You guys see all this? Just the formation of this whole menorah scene is beautiful. So you see that the vision or the image that is supposed to be reflected is off of this mirror. The mirror image of the Father is Yeshua himself, the Savior. This Hebrew word can be read another way, which is moreh, which means a teacher, as in the Messiah, who is the teacher of righteousness. He is the pattern and the image that we should measure up to. So when the menorah is molded after the sun, then we are ready to contain pure oil. But until then, you're not ready for the oil. There's no need to put oil in a vessel that's not ready. How is oil made? Remember, there's three different levels of making this oil. The first piercing of the olive is called extra virgin olive oil. That would be used and set aside for the anointing oil that was not to be burned. Then, as the olive is continued to be broken, that is virgin olive oil. And the last crushing process of the olives inside of the Gethsemane, the get, which means the press, then we have olive oil. That's used, that's used for the burning in the menorah. But remember this. There cannot be any pieces of the olive in the oil because it will hinder the burning of the flame. If you have any carnality in your life that is not dealt with, it will hinder the illuminating revelation that the Father has left inside of your heart and your spirit that you're responsible for. That's why the process of making this menorah is so profound. And there's much, much more that we can look at that we can't get into right now. But let's move on. I think I have something up here. Do I? No, I don't. It's Proverbs 20:27. The spirit of man is the lamp of Yahweh, searching all the inward parts, period. Scripture says in verse 2 of chapter 8, when you raise the light, this is to teach us that the lamplighter must hold the flame to the wick until the flame rises on its own. Period. All on its own. The ingredients of the flame, of the light, of the oil, all come together. How is a flame generated and sustained? By means of a lamp, consisting of oil, a wick, a vessel, containing in them so that the oil is fed through the wick to burn as a flame. Oil and wick are both combustible substances. One is you can set it on fire on its own, and the other one can be lit by itself even without the oil. So both of them are combustible. But neither could produce this light on its own with the efficiency and stability of the lamp. The wick, if ignited, would flare briefly and then die, and then utterly be consumed. As for the oil, one would find it extremely difficult to ignite it at all. But when wick and oil brought together in the lamp, they produce a controlled and a steady flow of light. When you bring the wick or your body, your fleshly nature, and you bring it in connection with the oil or the anointing of Elohim, it will bring a steady flow of illumination and light and be able to impact the people around you. There's an aspect called run and return. Remember? Ratzon v'shuv. Run and return. You're running to the Father during your prayer time, the way you live, but you don't forget to return here. Remember? Nadab and Abihu, they understood about the run and return, but they failed to return, and they were consumed. So thus, the wick is both prison and liberator for the flame. I like that. Both tether and lifeline. It holds the soul in its distinctiveness from the divine whole and its apartness from its creator. And yet, it is this distinctiveness and a set apartness, this incarnation in a physical life, which allows us to connect to Yahweh in the deepest and most meaningful way by fulfilling His will, by becoming light in this very world. I love it. So when the divine command, the physical body and the human life come together as oil, when the command of God and the human body and the life or the soul of the person come together as an oil wick in a lamp, the result is a flame, a relationship with God that is characterized by two conflicting drives, by a yearning to come close, coupled with a commitment to draw back, coming close to Him. As Paul said, it would be better if I leave and get away from you guys because I'm tired of you. But yet not me. I have a job to finish on this earth. He understood. So there's those things with running and returning. Running and returning. There's so much. So much.
I'm trying to set this up right because my cord is messed up.
Okay, here we go. There's only one thing to be kindled within the Mishkan, and it was the fire of the altar and the lamps of the menorah. Somebody said, what about the altar of incense? The altar of incense got its source from the altar of sacrifice, and it was used for that very such thing. But look at this. You have the altar and its fire kindled for sacrifice, and then we have the menorah and its light for illumination. You have the altar, one for access into the presence. Listen to this. The menorah, one because you have entered into the realm of the Ruach in the supernatural. And you have this other one here. Without the oil, the menorah remains in the state of 120 because the menorah weighed about 120 pounds. So without the oil, it's in the state of 120. Listen to me. Listen very carefully. We are building up to something very amazing here today in this Torah portion. As long as it is, we're going to learn something about us and things that are going on. So look at this. Without the oil, the menorah remains in the state of 120. Also a prophecy of the future of the end of the flesh. So 120 and no oil equals the flesh. You can look good. You could have went through a process, but you refuse to have any oil inside of you. You are just a nice looking piece of flesh, and that is not going to make it. We need the infilling of the Holy Spirit. We need to be empowered by the Spirit of Elohim. Not just having the knowledge of certain things. We need the empowerment to do things. The empowerment to do things. In Matthew chapter 25, verse 1 through 8, we have the 10 virgins. You have 5 foolish and 5 wise. What does the menorah in this parable have? What do they have in common? What is so connecting with these two? The virgin, according to the Tanakh, virgin has a physical and a spiritual meaning. The Hebrew word betula, which is one of the words for virgin, appears 50 times in the Old Testament, the Tanakh, generally meaning a girl of marriageable age. Pure, unspotted, and secluded from intercourse with a man, and thus a maiden. The other word for virgin is Alma. It appears 7 times in the Old Testament, known as the Tanakh, and could mean a young woman who has recently married but has not consummated the marriage of betrothal. In Psalm 119, verse 105, it says, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. In Proverbs, Mishle, remember the word Mishle, husbands should not forget this, wives should not forget this. The Hebrew word Mishle is the exact word given to Adam when he was to rule his wife. Remember, Adam was to be a Pharaoh taskmaster to his wife, wasn't he?
No.
Are you sure about that? You remember? No. To rule your house and your wife is to become a proverb. It's to become a wisdom. It's to become that. Because when husbands are not doing what they're supposed to do and the woman, the wife, is doing what she knows is supposed to be done, and the man's wondering, why is my wife all rebellious towards me? What it is she's walking out the Ezer Kenegdo. She's in your face now because you're not doing what the father needs you to do, and she's picking up the weight. And now she's trying to recreate something that you are supposed to be doing, and it messes everything up. So in Mishle chapter 6, verse 23 says this, "For the commandment is a lamp, and the Torah is light, and the reproofs of correction are the way of life." Thank the Father for the corrections that we need in our life, right? In this parable, Yeshua, on the third level of study called the Darash, which is a making a connection, a homiletical connection between Scripture. The lamp or the commandments is the word, and the ten virgins speak of the whole house of Israel and the nations and the good and the evil inclinations, as well as those who come to faith but refuse the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. We don't need that today. I don't believe in any of that. I believe that that was just Kundalini stuff and all this weird kind of stuff. No, there are some fallacies out there, right? Some falsehoods. But the empowerment of the Holy Spirit has never been anything else but the truth.
Hallelujah. Good word. Good word.
We have the five foolish did not have properly crushed olives for the lamp. They had oil mixed with the flesh of the olives. Listen to this. This is the five foolish virgins. This causes the fire to burn out quickly. The five wise did not have a mixed lifestyle after coming into the faith of the Messiah. The five foolish virgins, see the identity, they're virgins. That means they came into the saving faith and knowledge of the Messiah. But they begin to have a mixed life of carnality and oil, which is forbidden. They kept their oil free from the flesh, the wise virgins did, and ways of men which enabled them to have enough to get them through the time of testing and into the marriage banquet of Messiah. There is coming a time when there will be those who have the oil within them, but they have a mixture which is going to hinder during the time of tribulation and trial. Mixture is like that tear in the wheat growing up together, and the apostles say, rip them out together, just tear the ones out. The Messiah says, no. In the beginning stages, that's dangerous because they all look like each other. Let them grow up together. And at the appointed harvest time, you'll be able to tell them apart. Remember? The true ones that are bearing fruit bow over because they're weighted with the fruit of the Spirit. And the distinction is servanthood. When we can bow before the Creator like the wheat does in the wind, it gradually bows before its master and its Creator. When the trees grow up and they begin to be weighty with fruit, even creation knows to bow in your fruitfulness and weightiness. Even creation knows. So those who are tares that are standing straight up and saying, no, I'm not even going to be moved by the wind. Well, good for you, because there is a wind going to blow from the east. Mainly Saudi Arabia, that's going to blow across the world, and it will cause you to be dried up and become as stubble fit for the fires of hell. We need to be that wheat that bows over and surrender to the Master Himself. So mixture is like that tear that is growing up until the harvest time. Then the true ones will be revealed. The tribulation time and harvest season are like the evening when light and darkness commingle. Don't be like the five foolish virgins. Examine your life. These five foolish virgins had the lit lamps. They had their lamps lit. They had some oil in them. There was a portion of an anointing on their life. But they had carnality inside that kept that oil burning for a short period of time. And that is called deception. It seemed to burn and be on fire like everybody else. But when the harvest time arrived, their lamps burned out. That's why when those who seem like they have an anointing, and they do have some form of anointing, at the harvest time, that anointing will be proven. It might seem like they're doing this and they're doing that and they're doing this, but you know there's carnality there. You know there's pieces of olive skin, flesh there. We're not the Ruach HaKodesh. We're not the Holy Spirit. Let time deal with that. You see, the Father created time to keep things in order, to reveal hidden things and put to rest those things that were revealed. That's why there's nothing new under the sun. Time is a temporary belt that will be hung up when eternity comes in and says, your time has come. That's it. Time will be removed. They were able to seduce people for a season that they had the light, but it was insufficient to illuminate in a time of trial and tribulation. Defiled oil burns up quickly. Defiled oil burns up very quickly. And it cannot be replenished. That's why the foolish virgins wanted to buy some of the other ones. They said, no. You had your source then. Go get it from them. Well, they don't have any either. Well, that's your fault. We preserved ours. Now, you want to come and use what we have preserved? No. You lived as a spiritual Jezebel, harlot, whatever it was, a false virgin. Now you go where your source is and you cry out to the Father. Don't try to come purchase what we have.
Come on.
Because we kept it. And we preserved it and we sacrificed what we had to get to this point. You think I'm going to throw all that away so you can use mine up too and still continue in your carnality ways? No way. Yes. Let the tribulation time be your testing tool to purify you now. It dirties the lamps, the defiled oil. They received the belief, but they were already filled with man's mixed oils. Get out the old leaven, as the scripture says, and get out the new. Don't be an old wineskin. Be a new wineskin. Maybe they never pressed out their own carnality. We need to be in covenant Torah, and that's where we receive the full pressing and the full infilling of the Holy Spirit of Yahweh. On the day of Shavuot is covenant Torah presented to the bride of Mashiach, and that is also where the full power and infilling of the Holy Spirit comes, on that very day. On that very, the covenant of Yahweh and the infilling of the Ruach HaKodesh, the empowerment and the knowing on how to live, should go hand in hand. We can't be filled with man's mixed oils. There cannot be any carnality in our life as the days begin to grow dangerous and darker and darker and darker. You heard Brother Anthony yesterday. Last year, the whole class apologized for being foolish to him. This year, only one student. Look at where things are plummeting. The hearts are growing hard and colder. And the sad thing is within the body of Messiah, hearts are growing hard.
Yes.
And people are getting cold because they forget to keep the flame burning.
Yes.
They forget to keep the constant flow of the Holy Spirit in their life. We come to a place of knowing and we think, you know what? I begin to learn these things. I don't really feel that anymore. We need the infilling of His Spirit to sustain us in power. I'd rather know just a Hebrew alphabet and not even pronounce them all right and have the power of His Spirit. You can have all the other stuff. I'd love to have both at full capacity. But if I had to make a choice, you know what? I'll just learn the Hebrew alphabet. Give me your Spirit. Give me the infilling of your Spirit to be a captain to the people. Send me to the churches, send me to the crazy houses, send me where you want me to go, and let your Spirit move through these vessels, move through these hands, and move through my tongue, and move through my feet, and move through my entire being, and let me be an impacting power piece for your kingdom.
Yes.
Now let's look at some of the carnality that needs to be removed from our lives. In Galatians, I thought I had it up there. And I don't. I don't know why. It's something weird. I was trying to put these two together because of my cord. Galatians chapter 5 verse 19 says this. And the works of the flesh are known, which are these. Adultery, whoring, uncleanness, indecency, idolatry, drug sorcery, hatred, quarrels, jealousies, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions, envy, murders, drunkenness, wild parties, and the like, of which I forewarn you, Paul is telling the Galatians, even as I also said before, that those who practice such as these will not inherit the kingdom of God. Will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, trustworthiness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law. And those who are of Messiah have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires, ungodly passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. Let us not do any of that. Let us put these things away from us. Placed between the lamps and the face of the menorah, as we had just read, an interesting phrase is given, which is this. We have Beha'alotcha et hanorot el mul. You see the highlighted area? El mul. I love that. And now let's look at this wording here, because it's very interesting. El means strength, power, or a motion towards. It's the short version of the name of God. El means a strong, unstoppable movement towards or forward. Something that cannot be stopped. Something like a 2-mile-long railroad train going downhill from Cajon Pass at a straightaway. Nothing will stop it. It is an unstoppable movement forward. Mul is the Hebrew word for circumcised. It means front or facing or opposite. It's also the word for a flat musical note. The way I usually, if I try to sing, is like flat. Soft musical notes. It means a newborn speech. The value of El Mul is the same as the Hebrew word Be'ilah, which means her husband. So her husband, meaning Israel, her husband is looking for a woman who is moving strongly because of the anointing in her life towards him who has a mul, a circumcised heart. Very interesting. Very, very interesting. I don't know if I have anything else I do. So looking at this same Hebrew word, when you add one for each one of these words, we have 109, which is the Hebrew word, menucha, which means her resting place. Her husband is her resting place. The Messiah is the resting place for Israel. That's why he's called the Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace. But today, many people find their own resting place here in the world. They do. Once again, these letters give us the movement toward ascending, going up, entering into covenant, transformation from flesh to spirit. This is exactly what smoke does. And there's a mystery also of hair. Hair is the woman's beauty and covering, the scripture relates. A Levite was to shave his hair. A Nazarite was to shave his hair after the vow. And the highest part of the body is also known as the hair. Hair acts as the golden pipes or the tubes that are inside of the shulchan table, the table of showbread. They are the receptors for spirituality. So let's look at this. The shulchan table. Just as the shulchan table, which is the table of showbread in the tabernacle, had gold pipes, so hair is like receptors. Cutting hair and letting it grow anew is to go from one level to the next level, spiritually speaking. The Hebrew word for hair is segar in Hebrew. When vowelized another way, it's shugar, which means a gateway. Knowledge of the prince's seat. In order for the ascension, we must pass through the stages of 30, listen, 60, and 100-fold, as is mentioned in the scriptures. The flesh must be crushed. That phrase, when you kindle the lamps, Be'alotcha et hanerot. The highlighted letters, if you guys can see it, do I have it up there? Yes, right here. You see the highlighted letters in yellow? This is how beautiful the Hebrew language is. You see these things all through, and it's just profound. It's trillions of them. Trillions of them. Even scientists are blown away at this beautiful language. They're so profound. They have untapped prophecy. The Word of God, the Hebrew writings, are filled with the end of all things. It's just our knowledge is limited, so until it happens, we won't be able to cross-examine and find these things in there. But it is filled with everything. That's why it's called the Book of Life as well. The highlighted letters gives us the Hebrew word katat, which means to crush or pound, as in the olives for anointing oil, and to crush and pound the grain for unleavened bread. So embedded in this is also the process of becoming that oil. So I'm going to move on here because there's a whole lot that we have. The value of that word katat is 820, which gives us a few Hebrew words. One of them is ashman, which means desolate places. Listen, because these are prophetic words. As a masculine noun, it means a strong man. So the crushing is to remove the desolate space or place in our lives, and it is to remove the strongholds in our lives that can cause us to become the flame like the menorah, which constantly moves towards its highest potential. You see, that's what the crushing is for, to destroy the strongholds in our life. What did the Messiah say? If you can control, take control and bind the strong man, you can have the whole house. 820 is also the Hebrew word for sifatam, which is their language. A language which comes forth from this crushing or from a process breaking it down. So we begin to have a new speech in our life through this process. Another Hebrew word is shama'ati. It means I have heard you. I have listened. I have heard. I understand now. I've taken hold of your word, and I'm going to begin to walk according to what you say. I understand now. You see, the crushing is to get us to listen.
Come on.
To listen, to hear what the Father is saying, because we just can't. We get too religious. Or the pastor or the rabbi is not saying what we want to hear. That's because we need to be crushed. We need to be crushed. 820 also gives us the Hebrew word should sanctify themselves. So once you have crushed, you have been crushed, it's time to be sanctified by your own free will.
Whoa.
So let's look at this. And that's those there. The lighting of the menorah. Look at that. Beautiful. Beautiful. Once the menorah is lit, it alludes to true love. The lighting of the menorah by Aaron never became routine for him. Rather, it was always done with fervor and passion, deep desire. We see an allusion to this concept from the term Beha'alotcha, when you go or when you raise up, which has a value of 448, which gives us the Hebrew word Beha'avat, which means with or from love. So from love, I'm going to do this. The Father says, from love, I'm going to crush the Messiah. From love, I'm going to bring you through a testing time because I love you. When our children go astray, we swat them on the rear end because we love them. It's as awkward as that seems. The discipline, the trial, the tribulation is because He loves us. Proof text in the book of Deuteronomy, He says, I caused Israel to hunger and thirst. Why? He says, to see if they would love me and keep my commandments, the covenant that I have given. It's because He loves us, you guys. It is. The word ahava, can you guys say that? I love that word in Hebrew. Ahava is the word for love. Is encoded in the same phrase of Beha'alotcha ha et ha-nerot. As you guys can see, I think I have on the next page. No, I don't. No, you guys can't see it. It's included in there. I didn't give you guys everything. It's on my Word document that I typed out. You can have it. But let's look at this. Just as Aaron would light up the lights of the menorah with love and desire, passion and fervor, we too are to lift up the commandments in our life as the flame was lifted up on the menorah. Remember, the commandments in the covenant of God do not give you eternal life. Listen to what I'm going to tell you right now. You can keep all the commandments you want. That's not going to give you, say, eternal life per se. It'll get you in the world to come. Eternal life beyond time, beyond the 1,000-year reign, only comes through the blood of Messiah.
Yes.
and through the work of Mashiach. And that's why we can't judge the hearts of individuals. But the keeping of the commandments do save you. Because remember, all those different Hebrew words and Greek words for salvation, they don't all mean eternal life in the kingdom. A lot of them mean to save you from an immediate pending danger that can kill you. So salvation does not always mean eternal life. Very few times, I think two or three times, does it connect to that. Just as Aaron would light the menorah with love and fervor, we too are to be lit up with the commandments of God like a menorah. The illumination of the menorah is the revelation of all Israel who lives what the Father has said in His Torah. Applying this to our lives is to be as a menorah in this lifetime. Another connection is the process of prayer, which leads to elevating ourselves, and that's why you have the Amidah prayer as well that is given. The Amidah prayer is a parallel of the Our Father, living according to what the Our Father says. Let's move on. I want to move ahead because I have a lot to give you guys. No, I'm going to give you guys this. Yeah, I'll give you guys this here. Let's look at this. Let's look at this one. And this is dealing with the inauguration process with the Levites. So the Torah tells us that the Levites should be brought near before Yahweh. The meeting place in the inauguration service, the term used in Hebrew for to bring near is vehik ravat. And it's a related term to karbanot, which means the sacrifices and the offerings that are brought to the altar of ascension. Karbanot, sacrifices, and sacrifices are being brought close. It comes from the Hebrew word karav, which means to come near. The scripture says in James 4:8, draw near to God and He will draw near to you. In other words, karav is an animal sacrifice. That goes with what Paul says. He says, present your bodies a living sacrifice. Draw near to God in every way of your living. Every way of your living, that's when you become a living sacrifice. The value of this word is 713, which gives us the word teshuva, returning, repentance. So repentance, returning, is related to becoming a living sacrifice. Adding one for the word itself, we have the word haketoret, which is the incense from the altar of incense. So you see that all of these come together. Coming full circle, we have the rising up as the incense from the altar, crushed as powder for incense. One more word in connection is ve'ishto, which means and his wife. So embedded in these insights of the Levites is the intention of Mashiach drawing his bride near in holiness. Drawing her near in holiness. Another powerful result from the Atbash is a way of study. When we take the word for where all this is taking place for the nation of Israel is Bamidbar. So everything is transpiring that you just heard in the place of the wilderness. I needed to give you guys that just so you know. Let's look at Ner. This is the Hebrew word for the actual flame. The menorah is just jam-packed. The menorah is jam-packed. The Ner. The Ner of the menorah. Look at this. When you bring all the words, why did I skip that? That are in connection with Ner, you have from a deep mystery of the outpouring upon the west, from or in the womb, all of these. It's seen 28 times in the Torah or in the Tanakh, which correlates to the 28 golden pipes that kept the bread on the table of showbread fresh every single week. Every single week. So when we're looking at this, look at this. We have the outpouring of oil upon the scattered house and the nations, and out of the womb of their belly will come forth the deep mysteries, the prophetic words, and double portion anointing from the Torah, which is given through Moses to the people of Israel. And that's all inside of the word Ner. Look at this picture here. We have two eyes, two ears, two nostrils, and a bridge leading to the mouth. We are to cause our eyes to go up. This is what that means. We are to cause our ears to go up, cause our nostrils to go up, and cause our mouth to go up like a menorah, especially the mouth, especially the eyes, especially the ears, because the eyes and the ears and the mouth bring great deception if they're not harnessed. Yes. All of these are brought near to the Father. In chapter 8, verse 5 to 26, just kind of bringing this to a nutshell here, we have the work of the Levitical priesthood that's present in the rest of chapter 8. We know this was given because of what the golden calf system of worship that was created by, listen, by a Levite priest named Aaron. So the golden calf was presented under pressure by an actual Levite. And I put a little question out. Could it be that from a future Levitical system that there will be the manifestation of another golden image? Could there be a connection, maybe? One that functions like a golden calf. We need to press into the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. We need the anointing, seeing, and making of the menorah. We need the illuminating light of the menorah. We will come to learn that Israel will be in the wilderness for 40 years. And while in the wilderness, which is the tribulation time, they will encamp, or we will encamp, in 42 different places. These 42 encampments teach us of our spiritual growth and prophecy. That means everyone will have a 42 placement mindset during a trial and tribulation time. Your mindset will transition 42 times. Just like the super DNA helix makes a super coil 42 times, and then the telomeres present themselves at the end of our DNA, which gives us the mercy of Elohim of not dying immediately when we're born. That's medical proof, scientific proof. There's a 42 super coil of the DNA. It's called super coil helix DNA. And at the 42nd rotation, that's when we have the telomeres on the end of our DNA strands, which keeps us from aging too fast. Interesting. Very interesting that even in our DNA, the Father's teaching us about end time things. From Egypt to Sukkot in Numbers 33, we have Sukkot, we have Etham, we have Merar, all the name places. You guys got to check those out on your own. They equal Revelation 12 to 19. That reflects these places. Read up on it on your own. And the reenactment of them in our near future greater Exodus. Read those places in Numbers 33 and then study Revelation chapter 12 to 19. And it's going to correlate right in front of us. He gave us a roadmap. There will be no rapture. Surprise, surprise. Like we have been taught, there will be a catching away. There will be a rapture per se. A harpazo, a snatching out of the way, but not like we've been taught. If you claim to be a believer, then you will be guided through the tribulation by the Spirit of Yahweh and His covenant Torah. That's why we need to what? Follow the cloud. The scripture says to follow the cloud. What was the cloud? Well, let's see what the cloud was. This is what the cloud was. This is the same cloud that was upon Mount Sinai, the same fire and the same cloud. The Hebrew word for cloud is anan. Can you guys say anan?
Anan.
It's made up of an ayin and two nuns. So Yahweh watches over His seed and the generation to come as He guides them into the promised land. That's why you see two nuns in chapter 10, verse 35. Turn to your scriptures to chapter 9. In our Torah portion, Numbers 9, what we have is a second Passover. The only feast day, the only one that is allowed a second time. And what's so beautiful about this, just meditating upon that teaches us that Elohim, God, is the God of second chances. You find your second chance by the Passover lamb. Isn't that beautiful? Thank you, Father, for second chances. Those who just couldn't make it along with everybody else, the Father permits, you know what? I'm going to let you have two of them. He says, I'm going to give you a second chance. We serve the Elohim of second chances. Beautiful. The scripture says that all feasts were to be observed in the land of Israel, but how do you respond if someone asks you, why are you observing outside of the land, specifically Passover? The answer is in verse 10. One who was contaminated by a dead body or afar off in a distant land. So you can, we can observe the feast days. Why? We're in a distant land. Chapter 9, verse 10 gives us the answer. Why are you observing the feast? You're not in the land of Israel. Oh yeah, Numbers chapter 9, verse 10. We're in a distant land. We're permitted to do it.
That's right, come on.
In chapter 10, verse 1 through 34, which we're not going to read, we have the order of the breaking of the camp. And 1 year, I think 4 years ago, we went through the detail of the breaking of the camp, and we were connecting that to many verses in the book of Revelation. But down in chapter 10, verse 35 and 36, two verses, this is how it looks. These are called inverted noons. See that? It's an upside down noon at the end of these two verses. And in these two verses is great revelation. They're considered books of their own. And what is written in these two verses is, and I'm going to read it. When the ark would journey, Moses said, "Arise, Yahweh, and let your foes be scattered. Let those who hate you flee from before you." When the Messiah first came, the scripture says he scattered the enemies of God. When he was crucified, the enemies of God were scattered. And this is what's said when you take the ark, the Torah scroll out of the ark in synagogues. The first verse is read, and it's paraded around, and people are reaching out with their tzitzit, touching it, to try to kiss the Torah scroll. Imagine the Messiah, when he was born, you had Zechariah holding him up inside of the synagogue, the temple. It was his time, holding him up like a Torah scroll. And I bet you he was kissing the Messiah's cheek, and he said, "Thank you, for I have seen the salvation of God for the people of Israel."
Yeah.
And he will kiss the Messiah like they did the Torah scroll.
Yeah.
I could see it in little Yeshua, probably smiling little baby.
Yes.
And Zechariah, the father of John the Baptist, he saw the salvation of Israel come to the land. And he was holding them in his arms. What a beautiful thing. You see, when Yeshua was born, there was a cry that went out into the land. And it was out of the mouth of a little baby. And it was the cry of redemption has come.
Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you.
The second verse says this. And when it rested, he would say, "Reside, O Yahweh, return among the myriads of thousands of Israel." There's coming a time where Yeshua is going to return as the king, as the lion of the tribe of Judah, riding upon a white horse, meaning not a physical horse. He is coming with the authority of heaven. And he is going to burst through the clouds. He's going to pierce the skies. And there's going to be millions upon millions upon millions of saints that have died in him that were resurrected as the first fruits. All the prophets of old, all the patriarchs of old, all the matriarchs of old, all the angelic hosts of heaven are coming with Messiah to deal with the enemies of Israel and bring swift judgment upon the earth, beginning in Egypt of Mitzrayim. And the promise of Abraham will be once established again. In this earth, there will no longer be an Islamic regime. There will no longer be defiled governments. There will no longer be an ISIS or an ISIL. Beheadings will cease to exist. And the souls of our brothers and sisters will come riding on the horses with the king and say, "You thought you had killed me, for he that liveth, I liveth, and reign with the Almighty Master and the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who has risen from the dead, the one worthy to open the scrolls that were sealed, the one who purchased the land with his blood and redeemed fallen Adam since the Garden of Eden. This is the one who comes, and we are anticipating his coming. He comes to set the captives free." He said on the cross, he said, "Neshalem kalah." He said, "Be at peace, my bride. All is finished, and I come for you one day." The angel said, "As you've seen him ascend, he will in like manner return. Be of good cheer and do not fear." We serve an almighty God who has not forgotten, and he is going to return. We serve the King.
Yes.
We serve the righteous King. And that's what's said when they read verse 36. You see in Numbers chapter 10, it gives us a break and it reveals a small book that has the equivalent wisdom of the book of Genesis. The equivalent wisdom, this is a book in and of itself. And if you ask the Orthodox rabbis, they know that the letter Nun means the quickening of life. The quickening of life, an inverted Nun means the quickening of life from the dead. The quickening of life from the dead. That's why no matter how old we are, or what happens, or say we were in this building, y'all forbid it, we got surrounded by radical Islamists, I would not shut up. I would keep speaking, and they would not be able to behead me, because I'd fight them off with tooth and nail. And I would hold this mic, and I would declare the glory and the presence of the Almighty Mashiach. Who's going to return? I am so fired up.
Come on.
That's that Pentecostal. You see, I'm gripping this, and I think I made an imprint on the wood. That Pentecostal, you know, we were in a Pentecostal church, and everything starts running, but we have to have self-control too. So I'm restraining myself.
All right.
My wife says, behave. When you tell a grown man to behave, we just stare like, what? We still try to comprehend those things. Let's go to chapter 11. There's only one sign that the Messiah gave, and it was the sign of Jonah the prophet. He says, I only give you one sign. The sign of Jonah the prophet. 3 days and three nights he was in the belly of the fish, and if you read and you understand your Hebrew, Jonah died. He was dead in the stomach of the fish. He died, and he was speaking from Sheol, from the grave. And he cried out, and the Father resurrected him. And that fish, we went over it before, doesn't the Pope wear a giant fish hat?
Yeah.
If he were to look like this, it looks like a fish. You see, Catholicism, the universalism, is like that fish that has swallowed the prophetic word. But I'm telling you this, listen to me carefully. That cannot hold back the spirit of Elijah. That cannot hold back the spirit of Elijah. That fish, that entity, that universalism is going to spit out the prophetic word, because it cannot digest something like that.
That's right.
It cannot comprehend something like that. They can do all they want. But the prophetic word, the outpouring of the Ruach HaKodesh, we have seen nothing yet. It is going to be like a spiritual tsunami. And I always wondered why I had visions and dreams all the time since a little boy of massive tsunamis and tidal waves hitting. And the Father began to give me understanding, because in the end days, I would be alive to see the waves of His anointed ones hitting the coastlands, going through the cities, even if it meant death. We are going to see a powerful outpouring of this Spirit.
Yep.
Numbers chapter 11. The people were evil as those complaining in the ears of Yahweh. Yahweh heard, and His anger glowed, and the fire of Yahweh burned among them and devoured at the extreme edge of the camp. And the people cried to Moses, and Moses prayed to Yahweh, and the fire was quenched. And he called the name of the place Taberah, because of the fire of Yahweh burning among them. And the mixed multitude among them lusted with great lust. And the sons of Israel also turned back and wept. And said, in Egypt, for free. Wait, it says this. Who shall cause to eat the flesh? And we remember the fish that we ate in Egypt for free. The cucumbers, the melons, leeks, and onions, and garlic. We had great stir fry. Eating under the pagan idols of the time. We want to go back there because it was easy. And now our soul withers. There's nothing except this manna before our eyes. Now listen to this. This mixed multitude was more than the strangers and others that joined Israel out of Mitzrayim. These were also some of Israel. Lust is has always been the sin problem since the garden when the woman saw what? When the woman saw that the fruit was good. So look at this. We must guard our eye gates. What was lusted for was flesh. In Hebrew is basar. This word means flesh or good news, and this can be a twofold meaning. And is there a hunger and a desire for the good news, or is there a hunger for another good news? As Paul said in Galatians 1:6, I am surprised at how soon you have turned to another good news, away from the Mashiach who has called you to grace. A good news, verse 7, which does not even exist. Howbeit, there are men who have stirred. You turn to a good news that doesn't exist. Who have stirred you up and want to pervert the good news of the Messiah. But even if we or a cherub out of heaven should preach another good news to you beside the good news which we preach to you, let him be accursed. As we have said before, and now I say again, if anyone preaches a good news beside what you receive, let him be accursed. Not only did they lust for another good news, but they verbally attacked the manna. Remember? We know by looking at the word, this manna was symbolic of the Messiah. Mashiach is being verbally attacked indirectly right now. Listen to me. Indirectly, of course, directly for a long time, but indirectly right now. How is this? By embracing something lesser than the Melech Tzedek priesthood.
Come on now.
Because a lot of the Orthodox rabbis that don't believe, you have a lot of Orthodox now that do believe that Yeshua is Mashiach, but the ones that don't, they bash Yeshua. They bash because they don't believe he is right now. There was also the strange comment about three fish. All the fish was free, but if you look at Egyptology and the history of Mitzrayim, nothing was free. The fish was not free, it came from the Nile River. You didn't eat free, it cost you. So what is the scripture, why would the scripture put something that doesn't match history? Because it's speaking the truth. It was free fish, meaning this, free from the good news and from the covenant of Yahweh. It had none of that in there. They were eating that which brought multiplicity, and it looked like it was something good. The multitudes were there. There was big congregations and big whatever was there. Don't be fooled by the big massive churches.
Right.
Do not be fooled. Because the way the big churches go, and I'll tell you this, hands down, all of them. The way the big mega churches run, you have to stereotype and you have to commercialize everything. You have to. I've talked to certain pastors that are friends with people. They say you have to give people what they're looking for or you won't have a big congregation. And I said that the word of God is right. Do not follow a multitude. In the book of Exodus, do not follow a multitude. So the fish was free of the good news, free of Yahweh's holy standards, and it lacked a covenant connection. Verse 7, chapter 11. I got 20 minutes, so we're doing perfect. The train is moving, and it is not stopping. And the manna was like coriander seed, and its appearance like the look of bdellium resin gum. And the people went around and gathered it and around it in its meals, or beat it in mortars and boiled it in pan and made it into cakes. And its taste was like the taste of fresh oil. This is the manna. And remember in Hebrew, manna is minhu, which means who is he? They named it. They said, who is this? You see, when your desires are somewhere else, you won't even recognize the Messiah when he stands in front of you. It'll be foreign to you. It'll taste too challenging. There's too much salt in that. Salt means covenant. There's too much covenant in that. That's too much salt for me. And the people went around and they gathered all of this. Verse 10. And Moses heard the people weeping by its families, each one at the door of their tent. And the anger of Yahweh glowed exceedingly. And the eyes of Moses, it was evil. And Moses said to Yahweh, why have you done evil to your servant? Moses is weary now. And why have I not found grace in your eyes to put the burden of all the people on me? I have conceived all this people. He has given birth to the people. I have begotten it. That you say to me, carry it in your bosom as the foster father bears the suckling to the land which you have sworn to its fathers. Where shall I get flesh to give to these people? For they weep to me, saying, give to us flesh that we may eat. I am not able alone to bear all this people, for it is too heavy for me. And if you deal with thus with me, please quickly kill me, Moses said. If I have found grace in your eyes, then let me not look on my evil. And Yahweh said to Moshe, assemble to me 70 men of the elders of Israel whom you have known, that the elders of the people and its officers, and you shall take them to the tent of the congregation, and they shall line up themselves there with you, and I shall come down and speak with you there. And I will take of the Spirit which is upon you, and will put it on them, and they will bear the burden of the people with you. And you may not bear it yourself. And you shall say to the people, sanctify yourselves tomorrow, and you shall eat flesh. For you have wept in the ears of Yahweh, saying, who shall give us flesh? For we had good in Egypt. You see, there's coming a time when the people of God are going to wind up saying, you know what? The system is better than going through this wilderness season. I want to go back. Put me in a FEMA camp. At least I'll have 3 square meals a day. I don't care if it's by those renovated places where they put gas chambers. That's fine, man. Whatever. I'm hungry for flesh now. My flesh is crying out. I want, you know what? Give me the system. It was better in Egypt. You're going to hear that. You're going to hear that. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. These things are sanctified and set apart right now. Verse 20. But to the month of days, verse 19. You shall not eat 1 day, nor 2 days, nor 5 days, nor 10 days, nor 20 days, but to a month of days until it comes out of your nostrils. And it shall become, now listen. It shall become to you a loathsome thing because you have despised Yahweh. You see, craving after the world is to despise Yahweh. To be ungrateful for His provision in the midst of our dinner tables and homes is to despise Him, and He hates this. We should never complain. And I've been given this revelation years ago. You can ask my family, I don't complain about nothing. If we don't have it, I do not complain.
Yes,
and if I hear someone complain, I rebuke them. Because the Father hates complaining more than abominations.
Wow.
Who is in your midst and weep before Him, saying, why is it that we have come out of Egypt? And Moses said, the people in whose midst I am are 600,000 footmen. And you have said, I have given flesh to them, and they shall eat a month's days. Shall flock and herd be slaughtered for them? So may one find them? Are all the fish in the sea to be gathered for them, that one may find for them? And Yahweh said to Moses, Moses, is my hand too short to do this? Rebuke Moses. Now you shall see whether my word shall come to pass to you or not. And Moses went out and spoke to the people. Follow along, because it's going to get really heavy right now. Follow along. And Moses went out and spoke to the people the words of Yahweh, and gathered 70 men of the elders of the people, and caused them to stand around the tabernacle. And Yahweh came down in the cloud and spoke to him. Imagine that. And set apart of the Spirit which was on the Spirit that was on him, he put on the 70 men. And it happened as the Spirit rested on them that they prophesied, and they did not continue. Now let me try to find this. Right here. They prophesied, but they could not do this anymore. We have the knowledge of the word, it roots out fear. In John 14:17, there's a distinction between the Holy Spirit being with you and the Holy Spirit being in you. And the Messiah said in John 14:17, he says, the Holy Spirit has been with you, but it shall be in you. You shall be empowered. You haven't been empowered yet. 1 Corinthians 12:7-11, we have the ninefold operation of the gifts of the Spirit.
We have speaking mysteries in 1 Corinthians 14, 2-5. We have praying in the Holy Spirit, which helps the infirmities of the weak. We have the tongues of men, which is known languages, and tongues of angels in 1 Corinthians 14:14. And why would the follower of Yeshua, an obedient observer of the Torah, want to pray in a language of pagan nations so it was not something pagan? That is it. They wouldn't. The biblical gift of prophecy and tongues is for the body today, along with all the other gifts that are given to the body today. I want you to look at that. So we have, remember, the 28 golden pipes in the showbread, and this is something that's old. Alfred Edersheim had the book at home. He did the discovery on this. You have 28 golden pipes, but it's amazing that those 28 golden pipes that had air flowing through them in the midst of all 12 loaves, the 12 loaves of bread represent the entire nation of Israel that had the ruach, the wind, blowing through them. You have 9 fruits of the ruach HaKodesh. You have the 5 books of the Torah. You have the 5-fold ministry. And you have the 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit, which gives us 28. It gives us 28. So let's look at this. It says that they prophesied. It's Naba in Hebrew, and the way it's worded is with a Tav in the front. That means not only did they do that then and then was to stop, but the Tav in the front lets us know that the Father reserved the same thing for a future time. So look at this. You have Naba, according to Brown Driver Brig, Justinius lexicon, it means this, leaving out even some of the definitions, but here's what it means. To pour forth words of praising, edification, prophecy, and songs of divine power in a language not known by the speaker, known as the tongues of angels. And it is no coincidence that the value of this Hebrew word is 53, which gives us the Hebrew word ha-novel, yovel, which is the jubilee. The jubilee. We are about to enter a jubilee year, and it's a prophetic one at that. I got 12 minutes and I'm done. The infilling of the Ruach HaKodesh brings freedom. Jubilee, no matter what is going on around us, will bring us freedom. So we have the tongues of men in 1 Corinthians 13:1. Note that down. If you happen to be in a country and you are speaking in a language of that country, but you were never trained to do so, this is called the tongues of men. That's what that means. The tongues of men. And 1 Corinthians 13:1 is also the tongues of angels. This is when you are filled overflowing with His Spirit, His Holy Spirit, and begin to overflow out of the mouth in a language that you have never learned or heard before. In Numbers 11:26, it says this, and 2 of the men were left in the camp, and the name of them was Eldad and Medad, and they begin to prophesy, and Joshua comes, he complains, and Moses says this, down in verse 29, oh, that all the people of Yahweh were prophets, that Yahweh would put His Spirit on them. Today, you have a lot of people claiming to be a prophet, but yet their life doesn't match up with covenant. A prophet never veered away from the Word of God. When a prophet came, he did not come to tickle your booty. He did not come to tickle your armpits and tell you what you want to hear. A true prophet of God comes to rebuke us and bring us back to where we have strayed. Remember that. So if you go to a service and they're saying prophet so-and-so is going to be there, and he begins or she begins to go and veer away and just make you feel real good that you're going to be a millionaire and have a business like this and that, that is not a prophet of God. That is not a biblical prophet.
That's right.
It is not. A prophet of God is sent by God, is the mouth of God, and comes to bring swift rebuke. That's why the prophets in Scripture, everyone hated them. They came and people were like, oh my gosh, here comes the prophet again. That's why Isaiah, they laid him across the altar in the temple and sawed him in half from his stomach until his spine snapped. Other prophets, they pulled apart with horses. Elijah said, I'm out of here, you ain't doing that to me. Elijah was caught up. But when a prophet came to town, he was no friend of the people. Verse 32, and the people rose up all that day of chapter 11, and all that night and day after, and gathered the quails. Now listen, he who had least had gathered 10 omers, and they spread them out for themselves around the camp. Can you see Moses and the 70 elders looking, saying, oh my gosh, look at these people. They're eating quail. It's good at first. After a while, it's like, but they're forced to keep eating it. And the scripture says it was coming out of their nose. They had so much coming out of their nose. But watch this. The Hebrew word for quail is shelav. Can you say that?
Shelav.
It means sluggishness. So Yahweh gave them to eat of what was already on the inside of them. Sluggishness. And their sluggishness was coming out of their nose. You see, we need to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Sluggish people are those who do nothing for the kingdom but complain. They expect everyone else to do for them. They believe that they deserve to be served instead of serving others. These will eat the quail of the end times. Shelav also means, listen to this. This is going to be heavy. Shelav means Vatican influence. What is interesting, scripture calls this meat Yahweh gave them the quail. And I find it interesting that one of the leading men that speak and reveal things is Steve Quayle. But it says this, the quail, not Steve Quail, but the quail, a specific quail. It doesn't just say shelav, it says ha-shelav, the quail. That means this was something given, never given before, and it was pointed to something specific. Now watch this. In its ordinal value, we have 39, which is the same as Cosby, which means I will deceive. So there's a great deception embedded in the giving of this quail on the horizon. And Steve Quayle's been exposing that. We have been talking about it here for the past 2 years. This September 2015 will be a game changer worldwide when it comes to the economic collapse, the first Jesuit Pope, comes to America to speak. Sorry. The end of the Jade Helm 15 drills, which will go live before then. The mysterious and not so secretive asteroid that will hit the Earth on the southeast side of South America. Manifestation of alien and demonic entities, which are everywhere now, that the Pope himself, this Jesuit Pope, the first one ever, to say, hey, these are our brothers. Leave the aliens alone. These are our brothers. Those guys in the sky, leave them alone. They're our brothers alive from hell. He recently said this. Disruption in the sun that will possibly scorch the earth. Terminator drones being released beginning in Texas and California and worldwide. FEMA full operating camps. Religious extinction event. You guys ever hear of that? An REE? You heard of the ELE, extinction level events, but there's an REE already planned, and it's already signed by Mr. Obamanation himself. And it's called Religious Extinction Event.
Wow.
Numbers 11:33, the flesh was yet between their teeth and was not yet cut off, and the anger of Yahweh glowed among them. And the judgment hit them, and we have the graves of the lust. In chapter 12, now closing, verse 1 to 16. Let me see if I have this. Here we have Miriam, who is a prophetess according to Shimon 15:20. A terrible thing manifests upon her in the midst of all of Israel. The responsibility of the prophet is to rebuke and cause the people to repent, return to Yahweh, not cause Lashon Hara to manifest. Miriam, whose name means bitter, Bitter waters is a picture of Israel and the bride. She takes upon herself a leprous condition because of the evil speech, Lashon Hara. Our Mashiach has taken upon this condition, as is recorded in the Dead Sea Scrolls and many other texts that I have. His suffering was far beyond what we were taught by religious men. The scriptures declare him in Isaiah 53 and in the Dead Sea Scrolls and in the Messiah text and all these other writings as the leper scholar. Remember, we saw the leper in the beginning. His garment was prepared for him at the moment that Eve said, oh, we are not to touch it. The word there is naga. Eve, the first thing Eve gave birth to was the garment of leprosy for Yeshua back in the Garden of Eden. She didn't first give birth to Cain and Abel. She gave birth by her speech to the garment that was reserved for one person, Yeshua HaMashiach. So when he was born, he became the leper scholar. In chapter 12, verse 13, as you can see up on the board, we have Moses, he pleads for her. She becomes leprous and she's set apart. And we sang the song today. El narefa nala, fua shlema. El narefa nala, please heal my soul. Na is please. Moses says, El, please heal her. Please. The love that Moses had, the scripture says in Numbers, Moses was the most humble man that ever lived on the face of the earth. You see, humility will cause us and put us in a place even for those that were totally against us. A humble person can pray for his enemy. Yeshua said, pray for those who persecute you and despitefully use you. That's hard. And honestly, that's hard to do because we're in the process. Most of us, you know, they want to misuse me and forget them. Forget them. And there's, you know, slang terms that people use. We're not going to go there. So look at it. You guys are laughing. All right, look at it. El narefa nala, El, please provide healing now to her. The value is 449, which is the same for galut, which means the exiles. The plea is also for the exiles. Exiles, a type of leprosy. You see, the power of Moses' plea reaches to us too. This prayer is prophetic for the future exiles, the tribes of Israel. 449 equals talit, which means a prayer shawl. The covering of prayer. He covers us under his wings. My wife's just taught on the kanaf, on the tzitzit, on the woman with the issue of blood. He covers us. And it's the shadow of his wings that changes our image. Because it's slemo, which means his image is the same word for his shadow. So the covering of the shadow, that woman with the issue of blood, came under the shadow of Yeshua. Her image was already changed. And the touching of the garment was just a revelation that her blood was already dried up. She took on the image, the shadow of Mashiach. 449 is also Ha-Mikdash, which means the holy, as in the temple. So the temple is in need of healing. The temple mount is in need of great healing. In 12:13, Moses' prayer alluded to three things. Miriam being exiled, to request for Yahweh's protection of Miriam, since the tallit represents Elohim's covering and protection and protecting us. And finally, he asked to restore her to her previous level. Let's move on to something else here. Not that. Let's move on. There's a lot in here, you guys. Let's look at this. Here we go. There's a whole lot in here. Is this it? I'm trying to line this up. I'm glad we're not live right now like we were. I'm trying to do this right. I'm going to leave that alone. Here we go. This is what I'm going to look at. This is the name of our Torah portion in full spelling. So here we have the full spelling of the name of our Torah portion. And this happens to be an extensive revelation, but we won't be able to expound on this thing this year. Now look at this. What I do have is an interesting numerical connection. Again, the purpose of the Torah was to give identity and distinction to the sons of Israel, making us kings and priests after the order of Melchizedek. You guys agree with that? That's Exodus chapter 19, verse 6. Well, Beha'alotcha, the name of this Torah portion, equals Exodus 19, 6. We are to cause the flame of passion and desire to ascend up to the higher order of priesthood, which is in Mashiach. Not something lower than what the Messiah has done. It equals to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Those who lift up the light are a holy nation of priests and kings and give birth to many sons and daughters of this kingdom. This is the Melech Tzadik in Yeshua. So we see those scattered in Babylon and those who are far off will be gathered together, and in Teshuvah, repentance, shall receive the power of the Ruach HaKodesh before the great tribulation time. Now I'm not giving any prophetic things, but just interesting thoughts, very interesting thoughts. So look at this. 70 years ends the exile according to all biblical scripture. If we add 70 years to 1948, it comes to the year 2018. Could this be telling us something? And as I have, it's only a question, and I have my little happy face right there. Our parsha began with the lighting of the menorah lamps, so they would continually burn. In our days we are living in, there is the demand for an eternal and continual fire and passion for Yahweh. Keep your fire burning and never let it become extinguished because of the mixed oils of men, an imposed Levitical hierarchy that's on the rise, the destruction coming upon the earth, and most importantly, the Lashon Hara of doubt and rebellion. Hold the fire to the wick until it catches the flame of ascending holiness in your life and in the lives of those around you. In Acts chapter 16, verse 16, there is a spirit out there that has constricted the Torah observant believer from embracing the infilling and the power of the Ruach HaKodesh, and it's called the spirit of divination. Remember the woman in Acts that kept following Paul, and he turned and he called it. He said this, "You spirit of Python." That's a constricting spirit that tries to constrict everything from happening. What we have here trying to constrict the anointing of Shaul was the spirit of Python. If it is in the Torah, Numbers 11:25, remember that verse, then we are to embrace and pray that we receive it. Remove the constriction that might hinder you from walking in true power and holiness. Shabbat shalom, you guys. Thank you for listening. Father, we just bless and honor your mighty name. I pray that you would grace us with a fresh infilling of your Ruach. Remove out of us any forms of carnality and fleshly desires, those things that are ungodly, Father. Father, we repent and we ask for forgiveness for the sin that we've committed in our life, whether it was today, yesterday, or something we forgot. Father, I thank you for your mercy. I thank you for your grace. And now I just ask if there's anyone in need of prayer here. We're in the house of the believers right now. I would want you to stand up where you are. You see, when Yeshua did what he did for us, he did what he did publicly. Thank you, Irma. Father, we want to pray for Irma right now. Let's stretch our hands towards Irma. Father, we ask in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach that you would touch Irma's life, that you would help her in those areas that tend to try to rise up and cause her to retract, to cause her to go back. Father, we pray that you would strengthen her. She is not the same person that she was. You have set this woman free. You have delivered her from the bondages of sin and flesh. Father, she no longer walks in Galatians in those manifestations of the flesh, but she walks in Galatians 5, verse 22 to 23, the fruit of your spirit. Fill her afresh, Father, with your Ruach. and let there be a fresh anointing upon her life. Father, we just want to come in agreement and we cancel those any thoughts that are unclean. All temptations of the enemy that tend to come from the outskirts and behind like the Amalekites, Father, we just pray and ask they be severed right now in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Thank you for the blood. Thank you for the risen power and the resurrection power of Mashiach. For she has the mind of Messiah, and there is no longer defeat, discouragement, but there is encouragement and victory in her life. And I thank you right now. She lifts her hands in freedom. Let her walk in your power, Father. This day, hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I just pray, even if there's someone here that didn't want to stand up, that you meet them right where they're at. That you meet them right where they're at, Father, and you begin, Father, we ask that you begin to minister to that marriage, to that man and to that woman, to that son, to that daughter. That you begin to minister. Let this day be a day of newness, of breakthrough. We thank you, Abba, for freedom. This is a Jubilee season we're approaching. This is a Shemitah year where debts are canceled and bondages are broken. And we thank you, Abba, for your power and your spirit that resides on the inside of us. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Abba. Blessings, Shabbat Shalom, and Shavuot.